Oh my, hailing in Tennessee. Whatever are we going to do? This is, we're getting some bad weather over here. Wait, who's this? Is this the Suze in a Tesla?
Hey, man.
What? Suze, you got one? What?
I know.
Holy cow, man. Well, be careful in the hail. Look at this weather. Wait, who's this? Wait, who is this? Oh, it's John, too. Wait a minute. You both have one?
I misplaced my belt, and all the kids are wearing these looser pants these days. And in an effort to just keep up, you know,
the kids are wearing looser pants.
They are. And so I bought these pants, and they're, you know.
All invested in skinny jeans for so long.
Yeah. And now, you know, I was it. I was with it. And they changed what it was or it is. And now I don't know what it is. I'm not sure if I'm it anymore. But anyway, welcome to episode 29 of the Guitar Friends podcast.
Yeah.
29. My, how far we've come.
Yeah.
Dang.
29 episodes. What is the stats, Suze, on how many podcasts go to?
I've said it twice already. It's real low.
It's real low. Yeah. Very few podcasts make it to episode 29. Mm. Some would say it's really the line in the sand for podcasts. If we go after this, it's pretty smooth sailing to 100.
Yeah, just don't mess it up.
Mm-hmm. Don't mess it up. Don't get canceled. Don't get the sponsors to cancel. Mm. They already did. They went out of business.
Yeah, maybe that's one strategy of not getting your sponsors to cancel you is to not have sponsors.
There you go.
Mm.
There you go. Speaking of it changing, whatever it is, mm-hmm. I went to bed the other night and I don't know. I'm 37. You all are not.
No, haven't been for a while.
I'm the babe of the Guitar Friends.
I mean, I'm not that much older.
But we've all got kids. Mm-hmm. You know, we're all in a similar stage of life. We've all got guitars and kids. And I sometimes sleep on my stomach. And so I'll sleep with my arm up. Mm-hmm. Now, I usually won't stay there all night. But occasionally I will wake up and I'll realize I must have stayed here all night. Because I'll wake up and I'll sit up and my shoulder will be kind of sore. Mm. Like as though, it makes sense. My arm's up for hours and that muscle is contracting, mm-hmm. you know, whether it's under tension or not. But it's got to pull and it's got to stay like that, you know? And so it'll be a little sore for about 10 minutes or so, you know, feel it like it's just been, you know? And so, that happened to me one morning and I went to the bathroom and, you know, I went in my bathroom, not to the bathroom. You know, I went in my bathroom and I looked in the mirror and I came downstairs to get my cup of coffee. I look at Facebook. You know the first ad I see is? It says, are you sore when you wake up in the morning? And it had guy holding his arm like, ow. And I thought to myself, I didn't even say it out loud. I just thought it.
Right.
You know what I mean? So then I was going like, did they make my shoulder sore? Or did they just know about it? How did they know? You know what I mean? You know, you mention a product and then you go, see, it's listening. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean?
Right.
Like we were talking, I forget what it was. We went to this other family's house on Easter. You know, my kids got baptized because they're not heathens. And anyway, so we went on Easter, which is also sometimes called Jesus Visibility Day. I'm not sure if you... Right? Did I have that right? Joe Biden declared it Jesus Visibility Day. Wasn't that correct?
I think so. Yeah.
Something Visibility Day. Anyway, Jesus Visibility Day. We went to this family's house afterwards. And this little girl, you know, she's 11 going on 21. You know what I'm saying? And all she could talk about was Lululemon. And like, you know, maybe getting her nails done or something. You know what I mean?
Sounds like my daughter.
My wife shows me her phone later that day, Lululemon ad. She's like, I've never seen a Lululemon ad on Facebook before.
Right.
I'm like, right, they're listening. They're coming in and turning me over onto my stomach at night. I don't know. What's the agenda here? You know what I'm
saying?
How
do they do that?
How do they know my shoulder?
How do they turn you over at night? It's incredible.
Is it AI?
It must be.
Anyway.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah. Same thing. I mean, I don't get ads about the it. But,
yeah, I don't know. I don't know either, man.
I like that.
Yeah. I thought the best part of that intro was Jesus Visibility Day.
That was good.
I thought that was my best.
That got me.
That was my best work.
That got me. Good.
Episode 28, a lot to talk about.
29.
29, sorry. 29. Got some new picks in the mail. That's exciting. You guys are...
Gravity.
Yeah, you're holding some great guitars. John, you want to see if you can... What's your opinion of that thing? Because picks are now one of the things...
This pick?
We're at the point of guitar playing where we're spending $17 on a pick. You know what I'm saying?
Okay, so I'm actually really, really glad that you bought this because I've been looking at it.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a lot of money to spend on a pick.
It's as much as a Jimmy John sandwich.
It's really dumb how much these are.
Yeah.
But I have a couple of the JHS ones.
I just want to throw in, I've never lost a Jimmy John sandwich. But the pick.
Totally. I have eaten the pick on accident. The JHS ones, the ones that come in a... come in all JHS pedals?
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Supposed to, yeah.
I love that thing.
Yep.
I have two of them. It's the best. I've been using the Jim Dunlop Max Grip ones forever.
Sure.
And once I started using the Gravity pick, now the Jim Dunlop ones, I don't care for them anymore.
Yeah.
So these are really expensive. I'm glad you bought it. And I strummed two chords and I was like, yep, I like this one.
You're going to get one.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm going to get some of these.
Well, Mark,
I thought it might be too pointy. That was the problem.
Yeah. It does look pretty pointy and it's that color. And it looks like
color.
It would be...
It's just the pointiness.
Yeah.
I would... This is 1.5.
Mm-hmm.
I would actually like to see if they have a 2.
So they have really thick thing. Really thick. Like ridiculously thick. Yeah. I got that because I used the 1.5 Oltex, the Dunlop 1.5 Oltexes.
Okay.
And with the Rhino on them. And I've used those for years. The old formula was better. A couple years ago, they changed it and they changed the Rhino. Mm. He went from like 3D... He went to all black and white. That's just so like the five people that always complain.
Yeah.
You're off the podcast now. Yeah. You're already gone.
You've clicked off.
Only the real fans remain.
HW, please don't slurp into the mic. Okay. So I bought those and what I've learned about those picks is, and the JHS ones, when they cut the pick, you know, it's a smooth, they polish it smooth where you touch. Mm-hmm. But when they cut the shape, it's a rough cut.
Mm-hmm.
So see how it's rough on the outside there?
Mm-hmm.
On those edges? The JHS pick, when you go buy them from Gravity, comes in two different kind of flavors, where the edges smooth. Are rough or smooth edges. I've had them both. I notice all the ones I'm getting now, because we just ordered several JHS pedals. I bought the oil can delay and the taco bolt. Whatever bin they're grabbing them out of currently is all smooth.
Oh.
But the Gravity site says you could get either one. We make them both ways. Oh. So I ordered some not smooth, which I have, and then I ordered those. And I think the not smooth thing, I dig it. I like the...
Is this one not smooth?
Not smooth. So see how the edge, you can feel.
Yeah.
It's just not polished. It's just cut, and then that's it.
Yeah.
Whatever that saw
good.
Does. Yeah, let's hear it. You can really hear that pick tone.
Yeah, the pick is really adding everything.
Yeah. You know, it's like...
Can't even hear the guitar anymore.
What should we do? You know what I mean? Do we really want to make a video showing 10 picks back to back? I mean, would you watch that?
I mean, I think Andertons did a video like that one time.
Right.
They had 50 picks on the table.
And then at that point, you're just like listening, but it's something you just have to experience for yourself.
It really is, yeah.
If we were to sit here and do it, like Suze, I handed him that pick, and then he used a couple others. Mm-hmm. I noticed the tonal changes, but it's not something I would...
No, it's more about the feeling than anything else.
Just go get a pick and try it.
Do you like that one, the JHS one?
It's pretty good.
You still go for the...
Yeah, the, what are they called? Herco.
The scratchy one.
Herco, scratchy.
Yeah, they're real good.
I knew
Suze has the signature turn it around.
Yeah, you can't do that with these things.
Yeah.
No.
Maybe one day.
I knew a girl one time, she wanted the pick so light. She played a like a hand-me-down Ovation guitar. So like
of
the round back, you know?
She did.
It's like It's like the above ground pool of the acoustic guitar world. You know, it's like, well, you have one, but
right, it's like other ones.
Everyone's judging you. You know what I mean? It's like, I guess
you have to use a strap with those things.
Yeah, it's like, well,
not only are they the wrong shape, but they're also plastic on the back, so they just like slide off immediately.
It's like that rough, kind of raised.
Yeah. So much for tone wood.
Plastic. I don't know.
It's funny. Nobody's using plastic on the back of guitars anymore. That really went away. You'd think today there would be some sort of, I know there's like, you know, probably some carbon fiber or this or that, but back then they were just like plastic.
Did Parker Fly ever make a hollow body?
Yeah.
It was all carbon fiber. Can you imagine?
So, what were we talking about? I could hear the picks. I could hear the tonal difference. Anyway,
she had a thin pick.
She couldn't find picks, soft enough, like light enough.
Oh gosh.
So what she started doing, cause she's handed me a pick one day and it was all rough and jagged on the sides.
Them?
She was cutting them out of a binder. She had a binder for school that was like a clear plastic acrylic, and it was such thin plastic that she was like, I could cut picks out of here. So she traced a pick and was just cutting them out with scissors. Mm-mm. And she handed me one, and I was like, this is like a piece of paper. It's like so thin.
She's like, isn't it great?
Yeah. She was like, I know, but I love it. I love the,
wow.
Yeah.
She's like, that gives me a good idea.
That sounds terrible.
Yeah. I'm not friends with her anymore, but
I remember, so I remember going from like Fender when I first started playing guitar, my dad was like, here, use these. And it was like a Fender medium.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. 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 Of course.
Those picks, the Fender picks are terrible because eventually they break on the end.
Yes,
and then
they do.
Like catch your string.
They do. They, yeah.
They don't wear down. So then I switched to the nylon ones, but I was using like the gray ones, like the 7.77 ones.
A dark gray or light gray?
The light gray.
Yeah.
Right? They're kind of thin.
Yep.
And then like, I don't know, over the years, it's like, now, like I just said, I would rather get a 2.0.
What I think, how I think about it is this. If you use a soft pick, there's a definite sound. You know, Herco has a definite sound. And you can't do everything with a hard pick. But you can go as soft as you can be. And as hard as you can be. When you have a soft pick, it's almost like there's a limit of how hard you can pluck.
Yeah.
Because no matter how much force you use, whatever the force that thing will bend.
Right.
If there's any bend in your pick, you just reach a level where it's almost like compression. You get above this level and you get that value all the time.
Yeah.
With a hard pick, I feel like you get, the reason I've always gravitated towards harder picks, and mine was like yours, stiffer and stiffer until now. You know, and I've tried coins, you know, they sell those quarters and they're shaped. Yeah, I didn't like it either. But what I like about a hard pick is I really feel like I have a lot of control and I can go softer if I want. And I feel like it's the biggest difference between my fingers and the pick, which gives you the most difference. You know what I mean? But, you know, when Suze plays the Herco, I hear it. And like a Gretsch, it's a sound I like. I kind of wish I could emulate it, but as soon as I pick one of those up, I'm like, what is this thing, you know? It's just like too flimsy. But I dig it.
But you don't play with flimsy picks.
Compared to these, they are. They're under 1.0.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah, the Herco is like pretty.
Yeah.
Get out of here.
Yeah.
And you know what I wonder too?
Get out of here with those flimsy picks.
Yeah. When I played acoustic a lot, because for years, I would say until I moved to Nashville, I played acoustic guitar all the time and electric. But, you know, I would play acoustic guitar. And I always use softer picks. And somewhere along the lines, when I kind of put down the acoustic guitar, I stopped liking soft picks altogether. But I never liked those really hard ones with an acoustic, you know? There has to be like the right clack, you know what I mean, on an acoustic guitar. Yay, nay.
I don't know. I don't really play.
This is the most I've ever thought about picks before. But.
Yeah. I think this is excellent pick content.
This is the best pick content that someone will see the day they're watching it.
Yeah. The moment that they are clicking here.
I don't play acoustic guitar very often.
Right.
I don't like it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's not my thing.
Yeah.
You would think it would be similar, but it's really not.
It's a different thing.
I would just use the same picks, acoustic or electric.
Yeah.
Just whatever I've got.
Yeah.
I only have like two picks on me. I have a whole bowl of picks. from like NAMM. You come home with like 50.
Sure.
Yeah, yeah, sure. Everyone's got one.
You know, they're all garbage.
Most of the JHS picks that I feel like I have and are maybe floating around here were when I was leaving and Addison grabbed me a handful of picks and dumped them in my backpack.
Nice.
And he was like, I'm not going to work here. things that are sort of true.
Totally.
Let's get an extra one just so we can really get this transition. Suze can find the transition in the edit.
You really, I mean, wow, there was a bird in that one.
I know. There was a real, real high pitched whistle.
There was a bird.
Wow.
Fluttering around in there.
You know. Would you, can I ask you a question?
Sure.
Because I can.
That's why we're here.
I'm a pretty good whistler.
You are.
You ever know? You ever?
That's good.
You ever like kind of assess your whistle skills?
I have not.
Because I've noticed I'm not gonna say 0.1%, but top 1% of whistlers walking around.
Okay.
Uh huh.
Interesting.
Mario, Star Wars. I can do it all.
Interesting.
When I was young, I had a guy tell me, I started singing a little song. He was like, I bet you can whistle really well. And then I never saw that man again in my life. And I've always to this day wondered, what did he see that he knew was an indicator that I could whistle that well?
I bet you can whistle, Willard.
Because then I realized, and then I've also thought about this, is it because he sort of spoke that prophetic word of truth over my life that I can whistle well? Or did I just believe that I could whistle well, and so I've developed this useless whistling skill? Or did he actually listen to me singing this little song, something, maybe the way I was doing my vowels or something? Did he actually go, oh, you know what I mean?
This is the most I've ever thought about whistling.
This is that kind of episode.
They're going to say, HW, definitely microdosing. HW, definitely on something. People always put that stuff, you know? Right. Uh-huh. They always put that stuff. One time at community college, a professor asked a question. He's like, I won't ask the question, how many of you have experimented with marijuana? And people just laughed, and he goes, okay, I will ask the question. No one raised their hand. And at the time, I had never tried marijuana in any form, ingesting or smoking the carcinogen type. But then then the professor said, well, I'll ask this. How many of you have never tried marijuana? And I raised my hand. The eruption of laughter that came out as though I was being sarcastic. But I guess I just gave off a sort of... So it's not lost on me that some people might think that.
I mean, yeah.
It's something about the relaxed eyes. Or
I don't know that it's the eyes.
No, is it the sort of the off the top of the head?
Yeah.
Word string.
Not anyone can do what you do, unless they're inebriated. Most people are too inside their own head.
Just as a reminder.
We should replace the intro with just John whistling.
Right, yeah, yeah. Check this out. What about this?
Oh, man. Yeah, that could be good. That was...
I'm not a bad whistler.
Yeah.
I wasn't going to...
Pretty nice.
Steal the spotlight.
How's your whistle vibrato? I can't do it. I don't know. I could do it a little. I actually can, but I don't. I feel too on the spot. And when you feel a little too smiley,
you can't do it.
You have to have relaxed lips.
My older daughter has not developed the ability to whistle.
Oh.
She doesn't know how yet.
Yeah.
And I'm like, at this point, I'm like, just don't.
Yeah.
Like, it's okay. Just, you can go your whole life without doing it. Mm-hmm. It's fine.
But what if she really urgently needs to warn a dog to come back to her?
It's true.
You know?
I don't know.
Or what if like...
Sometimes I whistle at my dogs. They don't pay attention better when I whistle versus when I scream at them.
Right.
No, I don't scream at my dogs.
Maybe.
Talk loudly sometimes.
Yeah. Do you, when you get mad at your dog, do you call it dog?
No, I call them names.
Have you ever like seen their names or mean names?
Yeah, what kind of names?
No, mean names. I call them doofus.
Oh, that's not that mean.
Mm.
Or, no.
It gets meaner from
sometimes
there.
I call them like, I'm like, get inside, idiot.
Yeah, right.
You know? Mm. But they are. They're like a two-year-old child.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of dumb.
Do you think it's like when you speak, you know those experiments where you say nice things to plants and they grow a lot?
There's a bunch of videos on Instagram of people saying horrible things to their dog,
uh-huh.
but in a very upbeat and happy tone.
Yeah, right. And the and dogs are really happy.
They don't know the difference.
No, they don't know. They don't speak English.
No, they don't.
No.
So it's pretty funny.
But they know tone.
They know tone.
Some they say know we tone. Know tone.
They can learn words for sure.
Yeah.
But they don't speak the language.
No.
No.
Obviously not.
Mm-mm.
Obviously. I don't think they understand the language either. They for sure don't speak it, though.
No, yeah. Not fluently.
Wow.
Not fluently. Is this the most you've ever thought about dogs?
Yeah, it's like keeps...
There you go. You ever do this, by the way? I'm not sure if you know this, but your guitar can whistle, too. You know how to do that on the guitar? Turn up your volume. I'll teach you right now.
Okay.
Just go from the low, from the high E string, go from the lowest fret, just go... And then do it on the B. See?
Mm-hmm.
I like that. Is that how...
That's how I met Alyssa. In a bar.
Wow.
Doing covers. She walked by and went...
Is that how Steve Miller did it in that song?
Probably.
There's one where it's like a whistle.
There's a whistle.
Sure.
Yeah, do it again. It works.
It actually does.
It's perfect. Yeah.
I like that. I'm going to do that to my wife later and see if she notices.
Yeah, there you go.
Usually when I play guitar, she walks up to my office door and then closes it.
Yeah, right. Do that. Do that every time.
Sounds right.
That's perfect. It's going to sound really different, though, with like a drop tune guitar and a lot of gain.
No, it'll just sound a step lower.
True. Come on. True. Mm. Right. It'll sound, it'll sound like a lower whistle.
Yeah. Metal whistling.
Yeah. I don't think that I...
I almost choked.
I listen to a lot of metal, but when I play guitar, it's not metal.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Although I was playing along with just some metal the other day. I can do it. It's just, that's not what happens naturally.
Yeah.
You know?
You got dogs and a lawn. It's not that metal.
Like the whole lifestyle.
You know?
I know. I'm like taking my, kids to, ballet.
Mm-hmm.
Where's a Tesla on the metal scale?
Yeah.
Are we going to talk about
We already put at the beginning of the episode this little clip, so they already know.
Oh, the clip.
So we haven't shot the clip yet, but we'll shoot it out of order.
But just imagine.
Oh, yeah. Man.
Teslas are not metal.
Not metal. That's what I thought.
Not metal. Made of metal.
But I do listen to metal in the Tesla.
They actually have the largest press that makes the body in one piece.
Does it really?
Uh-huh. The Model Y is the largest. Yeah, it's called the Giga Press.
Of course it is.
They designed it, and then they found a company to make it for them.
What I like about Tesla is that they have a name for everything, like Apple does.
Uh-huh.
Everything has a name.
Yeah.
I just wish they would use consistent names for things.
Apple or Tesla?
Tesla, because it's very confusing.
Mm.
Well, Giga they use a lot. So Giga Berlin, Giga Texas, Giga Nevada.
Right.
Is it Giga Nevada? Giga... Hmm.
Why do they call it that?
Giga
means thousand.
Yeah.
So what does that mean?
It's bigger than the rest of the stuff. It's even bigger. It's a bigger company. It's a bigger facility. We're gonna build a Giga Berlin. And then they've got the Giga Press, which is really just large. It's just a large,
that's a big one.
So
does it press 1,000 cars at a time?
It is the largest thing that's pressed in a single piece.
Yeah. But it means a thing. It's not like big.
Uh-huh.
It's not like calling something big or huge.
Yeah.
Mm.
Do you know what I mean?
Right. Maybe when they started using it, it was like gigabyte was big. Gigabit internet.
Yeah, no,
giga speed.
But that means a number.
Yeah,
that has
an
actual meaning.
Remember when
more than a bit.
Yeah. It's not just,
Remember when 2000 came around though and everything used the word millennium? Even that Enrique Iglesias album was just millennium. He didn't make that many records. Zep 1, Zep 2. He went right to Millennium. It was like his fourth record.
Mm.
You know?
Hmm.
Doesn't mean that.
He's just like, I made it during the new millennium.
I think it came out in like 99.
Even
you know, was that no one was talking about Millennium right after 2000, you know?
No, it was all leading up to
yeah.
It.
Does mega mean a number?
Yeah.
What is mega?
I don't know.
Giga?
How about mecca?
Like megabyte, mecca. Gigabyte, these are all like numbers.
Oh, yeah, sure.
Yeah.
Sure. 100 maybe, I guess. I don't know.
Mega press.
First topic of the day. I didn't have a transition, so I was just trying to get us to the. To
you didn't have the end of the sentence.
Well, no, I have a topic.
We're just waiting.
I have a topic. I definitely have a topic.
We have to leave that all in now. So like,
I don't expect any part of this podcast to be edited out. I listen back to these. Do you guys listen back to this? We'll get to the thing in a second. Do you listen back?
I do not.
You edit it.
No.
You listen back. Your listen back. I mean,
I don't listen to it edited.
When it gets posted, I wait like a day or two,
mm-hmm.
and then I watch it a little bit and I see what the comments are saying.
Yeah,
but I never reply to anything like you guys do.
Once Suze edits it,
maybe I will start.
Once he edits it, I usually upload it to YouTube, and then before it comes out, I listen to it. Like while I'm doing other stuff, because I always think, was there something I said that I need to take out? You know what I mean? You know what?
It's good that you think that.
You know what I mean?
And then like a filter, like days later.
It's good to know that exists.
Well, but we've never taken anything out, have we? Maybe one thing we did take out.
Right.
We're leaving all these in.
I know. It's rough.
I think it's rough for the people who aren't on the video of it. Yeah. You know what I mean?
On that really, really,
it's
on the really long one
before,
you should put a bunch of reverb on it.
Sure.
Like make it sound like he's doing it.
It's already been done by this point of the edit.
Right. It was done already.
Yeah. I just did it 20 minutes ago. Isn't that insane? Wow. Meta. It's like inside the inception.
Wow. So
what was your first topic?
So the first topic I think this is a pretty interesting topic. So you may have seen that a lot of people are a little bit upset with Tonex. And my question is, what did Tonex really do wrong? What did IK really do wrong? So they released a new suite of amps or a new collection of tone models.
Mm-hmm.
And it was called the Metal Gem, I think. Metal Gems, like gems of the metal genre.
Like the best ones.
The best metal amps, yeah.
So it was after the Mesa Boogie one?
After the Mesa Boogie one.
Huh.
And after...
I get 1,000 emails a week from them, and I didn't see this one. I don't know.
We were in an email recently.
That's why
recently.
You missed it, because it was 930.
We were in an email recently.
I know you
were. And we have some more Tonex content coming out with pedals and stuff. But a lot of times, obviously, we're up there and partners and everything, and it's great.
Okay, so they came out with a Metal Gems one.
Metal Gems. And it was a bunch of cool amps. And a lot of people have been getting upset that this new collection is only open to new, or it's available, I think, for purchase, but it's free for new users who buy the Max package. So if you go buy a Tonex Max right now, you can get this Metal Gem collection. And I guess for everybody else, it's not free. You know, it's not just an update. It's a release they made. You know, and in the past, Tonex has... you know, they've made a lot of stuff for the platform.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we've made stuff for the platform. They've made stuff. A lot of people have made stuff, you know, all sorts of people. And this, I guess a lot of people feel like that's unfair that they are not getting these because a new user gets it.
Mm.
And my question is, well, why can't IK... just make a pack and sell it? Like, when did we start thinking, why are some people thinking I'm entitled to that? They can't make it and not give it to me if they give it to new users who sign up.
Right. That's the...
Yeah.
That's the rub.
We've seen... This is a common thing. Maybe not in this little world, but it's a common...
Yeah, like with cell phone companies, they're like, oh, get this killer deal, but only for new customers.
Yeah. When I first moved to Nashville, I remember I saw a sign. I was on a trip out here to look for an apartment. I saw a sign, and it said, it was cable service. You know, I've been in Nashville for 8-9 years now. It's a cable service, and it said, sign up for blah, blah, blah cable, and, or it said, new homeowner, sign up for cable and get, it was like a gift of your choice. It was either a high point 9mm handgun.
Wow.
Or two large pizzas.
And but for anyone who doesn't know, that's like the same monetary value.
That's the same monetary value. A high point guns are this is demonetized. We've said like the G-U-N word probably, but whatever. That is a, it's made of plastic, basically. Polymer is known for being really cheap.
Right,
and two cheap. Large pizzas is the cost of two large pizzas.
Right.
I don't know why.
That's the most Tennessee thing.
It was just very Tennessee. It was very Nashville, right?
Yeah.
It was very Nashville.
A high point.
It was very Nashville. And, it strikes me as, you know, it's a common thing. You give people, you're trying to attract new customers, you know?
Yeah.
I get people all the time who tell me, hey, I already bought the everything pack.
Mm-hmm.
I go, yeah. Well, thank you. Thank you. And, you know, sometimes they bought it at this price or that price, or then there's a flash sale or whatever.
Right.
And some people say, have I bought it this many times? And in my head, I always go to, well, when you bought it, what was advertised was in there, and you've used it. Like right. You've had the use of it for all these years. So someone new coming in right now, they haven't had the use of it for 2 years. There's some new price that may happen during this time, or the price might be higher or lower. Mm-hmm. It just might move around. But sometimes people seem to have the, you know, well, then if someone else gets something that I don't, or they get it cheaper, then I got ripped off and I paid for it for nothing.
Yeah.
And I always in my head go back to, well, but you had the use of it this whole time, which is some value, right? Like,
right.
So I don't know. It's a, what do you guys think?
What is Max? What is that?
Oh, so ToneX, so it's the Max version of the software. So there's different levels of the software. There's a free version that's pretty limited. You can play some of you can play some stuff that comes with it. And then I think you can load on like five. Like you get like five Tone Junkie things.
I think that's what so like when you get the pedal, you have that.
When you get the pedal, you get Max. Okay. Yeah, the ToneX Max.
Oh, you
I think
do.
There's okay. ToneX like SE is maybe free, and then there's like ToneX the regular. I can't remember what they call them. The regular one, but with
if you
ToneX
want to
Max,
make captures, you have to have the Max too.
Yeah, I think that's true.
Yeah,
and also, you know, all the stuff that's on the Max version of the pedal, they sell. They sell it to you. If you get a lower version, it doesn't come with all of the captures they've made.
Mm-hmm.
You can buy that stuff. But if you get the Max version, you get everything that's included with Max. Okay. It appears that this new thing is not included in Max. And I think that what might be the new kind of change. I don't know that they've released something in the past that hasn't been included in the past.
Right. Hmm. So it's included for new people.
New people.
But
get
it's
this
not
as
included
a bonus.
If you already own it.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I think it's really weird. Like, people do this at normal stores too, where they buy something and then they go 2 days later, they see that it's on sale, and they'll be like, hey, I bought this yesterday, but now it's on sale.
Remember that old Circuit City ad that was the whole thing? Like the little boy goes up and he's like, yesterday I bought this, but then today I saw this. It's like a lower price.
Yeah.
And they come out and they give him like 60 cents back. And he's like stoked, you know? It's like, that's the whole thing. It's like somebody got a better deal than you.
Yeah.
You
know? And I, you know, especially after working in like the software world for so long, like prices are not, they don't mean anything.
They move around.
Right.
It's literally finding what sells the best at some price. It's you could be making more money, and then at another price it's, you know, people don't find that it's valuable enough to warrant that price.
Yeah.
And you're trying to find the sweet spot.
I
don't know. It's like, and this is, I don't know. It's like, Do they have to now say when they sell things like, hey, this price is for everything that you see included, and we reserve the right to change what this means in the future? It's like, of course they do. You know?
Yeah, and yeah. I don't even know that they've represented we'll never put anything out. Like, I get that. Two things I'll say. One is I get people sometimes on a flash say, hey, I just bought this yesterday, and now you got this sale. Right. If it's a flash sale, I go, well, should you know, we? It's a limited thing. Like, did you get a...
Right.
I've had people who buy something, and then they see a flash sale. They go grab it, buy it again at that price, and ask me for a refund on the first one, which I'm always like, okay.
Oh, like in the same day? Like,
or maybe the next day.
Oh, wow.
You know? Hmm. I've had people do it a lot longer.
That's actually
too.
Less work for you, though.
Why? What do you mean?
No, I mean, it's just like, oh, you thought it good enough to buy it again. You know what I mean?
Well,
I don't know.
Well, then somehow they want me to go in and refund it. Yeah. I had one guy do it, and he had bought something like a month earlier. And I let it go, but that's, I was like, hey, man, this is a little...
Right.
The point of the flash sale isn't so that you can try to use it, and then I'll give you a refund on something. It's not a refund game. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
but I will say this. I've had you know, sometimes I do get people who you know, they really are like, you know what, they want the everything back to be a subscription for everything in the future forever.
Right.
And I go, well, I you know, now we got the lifetime pass, so right. That exists, but for a long time it didn't exist. You know.
Yeah.
But I don't know. Did they do anything wrong? That's my question. Did they do anything? Is it underhanded? They might have set a precedence by giving away the mm-hmm. other collections, adding it to Max later on, adding it to all users, you know?
Yeah,
but I don't know
that
they have.
Did they do that before with anything else?
No, and I think the other thing is this. They have released stuff that wasn't included, mm-hmm. but this is, I think, the first time they're saying new users get this. You know, and now the people are like, that's unfair.
Yeah, well, it's so funny, though, because how much does this thing cost if you buy it? $30? $50?
Yeah,
something like
that? Yeah, something like that, yeah.
If they ran a sale that was like, get $50 off Tonex if you buy it today, no one would say anything.
Yeah, no one would say anything. Mm. That's true.
You know? So it's like, what is it?
Yeah.
I don't know.
I think doing tone drinking for this many years has just taught me, like, when you buy something, you're making a decision that, like, today, the way it's presented, I'm making a decision to buy it in this state today. Mm-hmm. I'm not going to worry about what happens in the future. Because there's a lot of opportunity to, like, become discontent. Only my Tesla gets better with time. You know? Only it gets these live updates that keeps getting better and better.
Right.
I got a couple other things. The iPhone has some things that show up. But, you know,
yeah,
eventually, like right now, my iPhone, the battery wears down super fast because it's degraded, and the processor is like really getting clocked because it's mm-hmm. it's updated so many times. I've got an old processor that's really hitting mm-hmm. the battery. So, you know, it's a give and take. I get new features, but, you know, whatever. You guys, I was just saying, like, you guys just bought Teslas, and my 2019 Tesla has all the capability. I don't have the goat horn, you know, but the ones they made right after mine that do have that, do you have any updates on the goat horn? I just physically don't have the speaker, you know?
Anyway. You should get one.
Hmm.
Yeah. I think they did nothing wrong is what I'm saying.
Yeah.
I think people are just a little.
I don't think they did anything wrong either.
Yeah.
I mean,
it came out. A lot of people, I moderate a Facebook group, and people were complaining about it. And some people were, you know, reporting other people, and it's like, guys, it's fine. It's fine. Just, you enjoyed this product and the tones. It was worth it before this thing came out. Mm-hmm. How could it not be worth it now?
Right.
You mm-hmm. know?
That makes sense. Yeah.
I understand where they're coming from.
Because of the frustration?
Yeah, the frustration of, like, I bought this thing and now it's more value. It's now, had I waited, it's more valuable, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And, like, I can see that that's, like, rubs people the wrong way. You know,
but yeah, well, everyone wants to get the best deal out of everyone else.
Maybe. Like, so I think that's what I was thinking too. Like, how often do you, you know, if you want to buy, say there's something you need to buy for the house or whatever, and you're like on Amazon, you like scour through all these listings and you're like, oh, this has that. Everyone's in like, just interrogation mode to the max when you're trying to buy something.
Looking at reviews and comparing.
Yeah, and it's like, you know, and partly it's because, you know, you're buying something that you have never held or touched or whatever. And yeah. so you're trying to figure out if it's the right deal or not. So I get it, but it's like people are very hyper focused on getting the best deal possible.
Yeah.
When buying things online now.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And that's just the way the culture has turned out.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Where it used to be like you just walk through Kmart and whatever they have, that's what you can buy.
Right.
You either choose to or not. You have no idea what's happening in other Kmarts.
Yeah, blue light special.
Nothing compared to other people's things.
Yeah, so it's like, you know, I don't know. Yet another way that everyone being connected to everyone all the time is maybe not such a great idea.
It's true. You know, one time somebody shared a discount code. This is like 5-6 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
Someone shared a discount code. I don't even remember where. But somehow I got word of this discount code on K-Swiss. KSwiss.com.
I remember this.
Do you remember? Did I tell you about this?
Yes.
I texted everyone I knew. Did I text you?
I don't even know what that is. What's K-Swiss?
It's the shoe company.
They should make
K-Swiss.
Shoes.
K-Swiss. You ever see it? K-Swiss shoes? No. They're not hugely popular anymore, but.
This was epic.
I texted you. I texted literally everyone I know because what did it? Was it 70% off?
No, it was like 100% off.
No, it was still some. It was like 90%
off. It was so much percent off.
No, it was it was an amount. Because I remember it was an amount. Because I remember there were shoes you could get for free. And it was like $80 off.
Maybe that's what it is.
And so all of these products that were less than $80, it would make it free.
Mm-hmm.
And then if there were any items that were more, you know, like $93 parachute, $13.
Mm.
So I go, you guys, there's codes out there. And the code wasn't called. And sometimes you go on one of these discount sites, these, you know, what's a discount? Checkout
Retail
code.
Me not.
For, yeah. And you get a discount code. And you don't know what it's for, where they push it out. Is it an email or whatever? Yeah, a lot of times they don't work.
I've never had one work.
I've had them work a couple times.
Oh, never.
But so they had this one, and I go, and it's not called like employees only or like Goodwill. You know, it's not called anything like that.
Right.
And it starts making all these products free.
Right.
So I order some shoes, and then I'm like, oh, I like these shoes. I'll get these shoes. And then I'm like, I don't even really like these shoes, but they're free. And then I tell a friend, and then they're like, dude, I just ordered $300 worth of stuff. And I was
think
like,
we all ordered a lot of stuff.
We all just ordered. And I told everyone, dude, I must have texted 30 people. And I go, and then I even did somewhere it didn't, the discount didn't even cover the whole thing. Cause I was like, I'm basically going to be a K-Swiss distributor now. So I just kept buying. I was like, this is amazing. What is this sale? Are they going out of business? What is this? And of course, you know, Monday or Tuesday rolls around after the weekend and everything's refunded. And I get an email and it says that code no longer works or something like that.
Right.
Or it's like that code wasn't a correct code. It wasn't correct.
Right.
And it's like, okay. Who knows? Maybe this was save $80 on orders of 200 or more. You know what I mean? And maybe they forgot to put in the 200 or more.
Right.
You know, little parameter.
My memory of it is that it was like someone's name. The code was like someone's name. It was like type in Brad or something.
Joe Mazda.
Joe Mazda.
It was Joe Mazda.
Yeah.
Code Joe Mazda.
So you never got the shoes.
No.
It all got canceled.
No. But I like to think that me and the spider web of people that I connected,
right,
you know, ordered hundreds of thousands of dollars in K-Swiss.
Yeah.
Apparel, which, by the way, no one wanted.
Right.
Nobody wants K-Swiss
nobody
stuff.
Wanted.
No. Nobody wanted it. But
it was like, well, these are okay, and they're free.
They're free.
Yeah.
Free changes
I was
a lot.
Calling people, what size is your kid? Well, I was calling my sister.
Gosh.
What size is he? And then I remember I got my kids, I think, a pair of shoes, and I ordered one size up and another size up. And I was like, we got
the
shoes
code's going away
for the next three size ups.
Right. Yeah.
They can
ahead.
Just, they'll be the kids who wear those shoes. It'll be their signature shoe.
Right. Yeah.
Cause they're not getting out of them.
I love that.
Did you ever remember those LA Gear shoes? They lit up in the back, LA Lights and LA Gear. Remember you stepped on it and a light flashed in the back. They had a program and my mom did this. If your shoes were still in good shape, like really good shape, but your kid grew too fast, You could like mail it in and they'd switch you out to another pair for $20.
Hmm.
And we did this a couple times. And I mean, I don't remember my shoes being that nice, but they had some life left in them. You know what I mean? But we did that a couple times. I think I had those same LA lights for like three sizes because we just kept doing it until it was like, we're not going to do that anymore. You know, those were the days.
Those were the days.
LA lights, LA gear, LA looks. Remember that? The gel? That was in the spiky hair era.
LA looks.
Yeah. Man, I use so much hair gel. It was
like a 5-gallon tub of gel.
Oh, yeah. For years, always in neon colors.
It was all crunchy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I used so, I think there was years, probably a couple decades there, where I used so much hair gel. I could never get it all out of my hair, really. It was like infused in the DNA of my hair. If I would just get out of the shower and just like dry my hair would still stand up. And you'd touch it, it was still a little like, you know, like crinkly.
Maybe you just weren't washing it very well.
I was a kid, so who knows? I see the way my kids wash themselves.
Yeah.
Anyway, so Tonex, maybe they did nothing wrong. John, you've been hard at work doing some stuff.
Have I?
Yeah, you know, but you told me you noticed some differences in some...
I was noticing something...
This guy's about to let a major cat out of the bag. The cat stays in the bag right now.
Right, I know.
The cat's not ready to come out of the bag.
Tell us, John.
The cat's not ready. So I've been working on the quad cortex a lot and the Kemper a lot.
Mm-hmm.
If you make a profile clean on the Kemper,
yeah,
and you dime the gain afterward.
If you make a clean profile on the Kemper and you dime the gain afterward.
Or like like a crunchy.
Yeah.
And you dime the gain afterward.
Sure.
It's not pleasant.
No.
It's not good.
No.
You don't like it.
Yeah.
It really works well on the quad cortex.
If you make a clean and then you dime it.
If you have like a dirty profile and you just gain it up. It works very well.
Mm.
Hmm.
Have you guys noticed this or tried
it? Probably not.
My first reaction everything is dime the gain and see what happens.
So what I think is happening is this.
Make a t-shirt that says that.
I could be wrong.
Dime the gain,
but
bro.
My understanding is that from using the devices, quad cortex and Tonex, the gain knob is an input gain.
Because I've actually noticed that the gain knob on Tonex works well also.
Yeah. So what you're doing is taking the same thing and just slamming decibels in the front of it.
There you go.
And everything sounds better boosted, right? The Kemper is actually making a, for lack of a better term, model of the amp and modeling its gain increasing.
Right.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So you're it's not the same as if you put a boost in front of the Kemper amp and just up the decibels.
Right.
That would be, I think, more similar. Because I notice you cannot nothing cleans up like the Kemper.
So the Kemper cleans up very well.
Yes.
Right? Like, it works the opposite way incredibly.
And you're saying a pretty big difference. Like, you're saying gain at where's, I mean, look at my little lights here.
Yeah, like that, right?
This is a liquid profile too. It's literally designed to be. But you mean this type of thing? Let me find a non-liquid here.
Yeah.
So you're saying that the opposite is true, that the quad cortex doesn't do a good job of a dirty profile.
I haven't tried cleaning up a quad cortex capture.
It doesn't really. It begins to me to sound like what it's doing, which is it's lowering the input going in.
Right.
So you start to get this weaker and
like
weaker
a spitty,
input.
Quieter.
Yeah, and it just gets, it cleans up like a thing. But you don't get the sensation of like I had a roaring Marshall and all of a sudden I have a squeaky clean Marshall.
Right.
You just get this lower and lower.
Yeah, where the way Kemper does it.
So here's 1-1. That's the maximum Kemper gain.
It's not great.
I mean, that's a really ridiculous one. I mean, just to be fair, a 5E3 can't get that amount of gain either,
totally.
Right? So
no,
we're getting into like
beyond what the actual amp was doing.
It's a theoretical.
Yeah.
You know.
And the way I discovered, or what I was trying to do is I was playing a capture that was the dirtiest that amp could have gotten.
Yes.
And I was like, I wonder if it's got a little more juice in it. And the quad cortex did what I wanted.
Because here's the dirtiest I can get my deluxe. It sounds pretty close. Okay, that is the... Okay, now let's try this. Just for fun. Here's the Kemper on 1-1, and I'll put it at the same amount of gain. There's definitely a similar characteristic, but when we raise that gain from 1-1 up to 1-5, I definitely hear this high-end shrilliness that's sort of there that is not on the normal one. Like it's taking like it's taking things that are maybe there and it's going up, and there's a quality there. Like
it's
play
actually,
this again,
it's
you hear this
better than I remember. I have not tried this in a while.
So that's 1-1 turned up to about the level of 1-5, and then here's 1-5. There seems to be some hot extra, like high-end sizzle that I don't love when you roll it up too much. But this is also stopping at the point that a deluxe would not keep going.
Right.
If you take this 1-5 and we up this,
right now we're past what the actual amp can even do.
We're past what it can do, but we're not going all the way to 10. We're going on the Kemper. We're going from 4.6 to 7. So this is like. This is more than a deluxe could do, but it's not the max the Kemper can do. You know, it's not heavy metal.
Right.
So try this. That's on 7. Now I'll take this 1-1 and I'll put it on 7.
I mean, it's definitely way noisier.
Yeah, noisier. Than, there's like a lot of high end. You could play with the definition, and I would with something that.
Maybe it's actually better than I remember.
It's actually
not terrible.
I've always thought it was pretty good. Now I will say this: the deluxe here is already like try this. Like this is pretty clean. You're on singles. There's already a little character of the breakup. If you take a twin, squeaky clean. I mean, no breakup at all. And you juice that thing up. It sounds nothing like a twin. Because when there's like no breakup in the sound, I think it doesn't know at all.
Yeah, there's nothing to...
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because as the Kemper's profiling, it like slowly ramps up the volume.
Yeah, to see where the gain comes in.
To see how the gain changes.
Yeah.
And then I guess it just carries that after.
Forever. It just keeps going.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Huh.
Yeah. That was better than...
That was better than I thought. Actually, yeah. I proved myself to be maybe, I don't know, maybe down on the Kemper a little too hard.
I think, though, what you're saying is they will behave very differently because I know the Tonex is an input up and down gain. Mm-hmm. The Quad Cortex, I think, is that. But I've never heard that. It sounds like.
It's more like slamming the front end of an amp with a pedal or something.
Yeah. And then same thing if you go down. Mm. It's like, you know, the second input on a Fender, you know, it's 3 or 6 dB lower. It's just padded.
Mm.
And it's supposed to be for if you ever see the low input, it's supposed to just be for a higher output instrument.
Mm.
That way you get the same. Mm. But half the fun of guitar is overdrive. So why would you do that?
Totally.
But at the time, you know,
I would say all the fun of a guitar is okay.
Yeah, but you know, especially for the low, for those instruments, especially for the you know, humbuckers were out by the time the 60s are around, and
right.
And I think they thought basses were going to go through that stuff, microphones too. Mm-hmm. You know, a microphone with a tube in it, you're playing the harmonica or whatever,
right?
Your active accordion. That's what they were doing, man.
That's what they were doing.
Funny. We were shooting earlier.
Wait, they had what's an active accordion?
Oh, I don't know. If someone make an accordion, you plug into a wall. I was just thinking like an active pickup in an accordion.
Oh.
There's a couple
accordions
amps.
Are incredibly loud.
They are.
They're very loud.
I was thinking we were doing some amps earlier, and one of them had instrument, accordion, and mic. Three different inputs. They all sounded the same.
Mm.
Yeah.
and it was M-I-K-E.
Yeah, M-I-K-E.
Oh.
Yeah.
It really was.
M-I-K-E.
M-I-K.
I like that.
Yeah. M-I-K-E.
They hadn't decided yet.
No.
I like that.
Yeah. Okay. Just without looking, because they can see, but you can't see. How long do you think we've gone already? I'm going to guess this. I wish we could write it down so you don't hear what I'm about to say. I'm going to guess what you're going to guess.
We should all say it at the same time.
You could write it down.
Oh, don't look at this.
Oh, I can't see
that. I can't see that.
Okay, good. Yeah.
I have a number in my mind.
Okay.
Do you?
I do.
Your number is higher than our numbers.
You think my number is higher than... so it doesn't really...
But I'm just saying, yes, I think your number is higher than John's and higher than the actual number.
Oh, okay. All right. So you say the actual number, you say your guess.
Yes.
And I'll say my guess.
You just say yours, and I've already made my claim, right?
48 minutes.
I was going to say 43.
Wow. I am completely wrong. Your number is lower than the actual number.
Oh.
How long
have we been? Not far from his.
And not far.
How long have we been going?
57 minutes. Just shows how riveting this episode has been already.
No,
and we're not done. We're not done.
Not even close.
Not even close. Not even close. That was the cold open, guys. Here's the
welcome
subject.
Welcome to episode 29.
You should play the Guitar Friends intro again. Right
Yeah, play it right here.
Yeah.
How are the cars treating you guys? You dig them? You do it?
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
Did you ever think, is this just going to devolve into a Tesla podcast?
I bet a lot of people hope it doesn't, but yeah.
Yeah, a lot of...
The Tesla is great. It's a car I've always wanted.
Right.
It felt like a car I would never be able to have.
Yeah.
Right. And then the stars aligned.
I had an interesting experience at our Easter get together because I told everyone, hey, I got a new car. And they're like, oh, what'd you get? I was like, I got a Tesla. Like, what? You know, it was like this big reaction.
Right.
Like, how did you? And it was by the end of the conversation, I could tell that Shelly's mom was like really into it. And she's like, oh, maybe I'll get one. They're so affordable. And like all this. And her dad was like, you know, they blow up on the freeways and just kind of like, you know, they catch on fire and, you know, well, you got to change the tires. And, you know, it was like they were polarized by it. Like excited.
Right.
And he's a car guy. Like he has worked on cars his whole life and has vintage cars in his garage and that kind of thing. So, yeah, his son-in-law buying a Tesla is not on top on his.
That's really interesting. You know,
that's really funny.
Happy list.
Can I tell you something my daughter said that I thought was so funny?
Yeah, yeah.
So... I had ordered it, I don't know, it was like the day after I drove yours.
Yeah.
And I was like, shoot, man, I think I got
it. Uh-oh. I always tell people, don't drive unless you're going to get one.
I know.
Because it's a really sticky thing.
Right. But, so I ordered it, and then I wasn't picking it up till the next day.
Mm-hmm.
And I told my daughter that night. I wasn't going to tell her, my wife told her. She was like freaking out, and she was like over the moon. I don't know why. It's not like I talk about him all the time, actually.
I was going to ask, like, what was her perception of a Tesla?
I think her perception is that it's like
Is your older daughter?
No, my younger daughter.
Oh, okay.
She's 10, though.
Yeah.
So it's like, I feel like her perception is that it's like a really fancy car and like very futuristic. You know, I do always talk about like they drive themselves and that whole thing. So she said two things that were so funny. She was like screaming in the car and I was like, hey, chill out. Calm down. It's like too much. She's like, you're being really cool about this. I don't know how you're being so cool about this. I was like, well, I'm older than you.
Yeah, yeah. I'm not 10 years old.
But then we were talking later and she's like, so can you drive it through the car wash? And I was like, yeah, it's a car.
There's things about it that seem like it's not a normal car, but I know, like in
but
other
like
ways,
most of the time
it's a normal car.
Kind of just a normal car. Yeah. And I think that's what's funny about telling people that you bought a Tesla is they ask like the weirdest questions.
Totally.
Yeah, it's sort of in the category.
Everyone asks, the first question is, how far can you drive?
Yes.
That's always the first question.
And now that I have a Tesla, I realize how little that matters to me. Like,
yes.
Because it's like... I would have to exhaust all of its range in one day because I'm going to charge it every night.
And the question really should be, what percentage of your daily commute is the range of the car?
Exactly. Totally.
In which case, you're like 24%. It's like, oh, okay.
Right.
Yeah. So as long as you don't drive four times that in a day. Like, no, totally. Like, you're experiencing.
Or charge it once a week.
Yeah.
If I was charging once a week, like, and maybe that's what they think. They go to the gas station every week or every other week or whatever. But like, so, yeah, like you said, if there was a gas station in your house and you filled up your car every night,
yeah,
you would never worry about gas, you know, like, and that's the
whole
thing.
You'd never think, I gotta get gas.
Yeah. Yeah. So you leave at 80% every day. You'd have to go a long way. You're either on a road trip or you're commuting.
Wherever you want, 80, 90, 100, whatever.
Yeah. It's a totally different way of thinking about it for sure. Yeah, it is interesting, though, like you were saying, you know, that even the cars we bought were $20,000 more a year ago.
I know, that's wild.
Like, and so the floor to get in, like the, you know, the entry level.
Well, and
it's one of the few things going down right now.
Right.
What's that?
It's one of the few things going down
right
now.
Oh, right, yeah.
Totally. Yeah, think about it. We talk about guitars here all the time, how expensive they are. And it's like, you know. Everything else is more expensive too.
And then people are going to say, now listen, people are going to say, oh, well, yeah, they're going down because no one wants Teslas anymore. When I bought my Model 3, I remember Tesla said that their margins were super low on the Model 3 in the report, in the investor call, you know, the explaining the performance for, you know, one quarter or something. And they said our margins are very low, you know, and they're going to go up to this and this and this and this and this as costs come down. And that turned out. But I bought my car and I remember someone said, I mean, the margins on these things are like nothing. And I remember telling that guy, yeah, good. Why would I want to pay for a high margin vehicle? I'm paying the least amount above the cost to manufacture this car of any car now.
Right.
I want to do that. So I would just say that about the, you know, right now their cars are coming down and someone might go, they got 40,000 undelivered vehicles, you know?
Yeah.
Great, go buy one. Like,
right. That's
like,
it.
Recognize a good deal. Yeah, you know what I mean? Like, don't, you know, you can go buy, you know, there's nothing wrong with an F-150. They make a lot of money when you buy an F-150.
Right.
It's the most popular truck. It's basically Ford's entire business. Yeah. All the rest is just fluff.
Right.
The F-150 is the entire company. Nothing wrong with those cars. I'm just saying, if something's coming down in price, now all cars have come down. It's not just Tesla. But
all cars are, maybe they have, but they're all more expensive than they were 5 years ago.
True.
Mm-hmm. You know.
True. Yeah.
So
yeah, the Model Y today is actually less money than the day it launched.
Yeah,
right.
Like this is the cheapest.
That's wild.
Yeah,
I know.
And that's with the incentive you're talking to, right?
Yeah,
the $7,500.
Yeah,
$7,500.
I guess that'll go away eventually.
Yeah, I wonder if
it's gone away twice and come back. They just keep. It's not gonna go. Look, it's actually not going away, ever, probably.
Right. It's just that things qualify or don't qualify for it.
It's now in a bucket of things the government does. Right. That they started doing when there was an emergency and now have just become the normal amount. Yeah. If you just look at spending bills, this is what they did.
That's how they always
do it. If you just look at spending bills and you look back through time, we did some stuff in 08 and, you know, it's like you can't put toothpaste back. And once they spent that much money in 08, it meant spending that much money was okay. Mm-hmm. Well, maybe we'll stretch out over 5 years or we'll do these longer things. And then the same thing has happened with COVID. Mm-hmm. Nobody talks about tens of billions of dollar bills. Everything's $100 billion or trillion dollar bills now. Everything's these giant.
I mean,
everything's in the trillions now.
I think my own finances have worked that way. Or it's like, I used to stress about a $300 car payment.
Sure.
Do you know what I mean?
Yes.
And it's like, well, now that it's only this much more, it's not too bad.
Right? Yeah.
It's like a couple rounds of that, and all of a sudden, it's like, oh, man.
Yeah.
I pay a lot more for my car than I used to, but somehow I don't care as much. Huh. So.
Yeah.
Oh, well.
Welcome to 2024.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's it.
We just chalk it up to inflation, and everything's more expensive nowadays.
Uh-huh.
Too true.
But, yeah. 10 out of 10, would recommend.
Would recommend the Model Y. Yeah,
that's great.
Mm-hmm. But the panel gaps.
I don't know. We've also started, speaking of panel gaps, we also have started seeing Tesla trucks out in the wild.
Well, that is what I really want. I really want the Cybertruck.
That's been exciting.
That's going to be my next Cybertruck.
The wheels and tires of the Cybertruck are the coolest wheels and tires out on the market.
Yeah. Mm.
So you're split on this thing.
They are very cool.
You think the truck is ridiculous?
That car, the truck overall, is the ugliest thing that's on the road.
Sitting on great tires.
By a wide margin.
Yeah. Yeah.
But the tires are excellent.
Just like close your eyes like that. Right?
Close your eyes. Yeah. The first time I saw one in person and walked around it, it's like they're way bigger than you expect them to be somehow.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And there's no curved surface on the whole thing. And the windshield is outrageously
enormous.
Ridiculous.
The windshield wiper is enormous. Do you know what's weird about the car?
It's every like a time 2x4.
It's just huge.
It's,
it's like a flagpole. It's just like going across.
It's so big.
Every time I think of a Cybertruck in my head, I like can't picture it. I'm like, that can't be what it looks like. Or I'm like, have it wrong. It's like not clear. And so I'm like, let me look at it again. And so it's like, I look it up again. Right?
Yeah.
And like, yeah, I got it. But it's like, it's so strange.
Yeah.
It's hard for me to even categorize a real mirror. And then seeing it in person was way different.
It's an experience.
If you haven't seen one in person, drive to a Tesla showroom and go look at one. It's like hearing Hendrix for the first time. It'll make you feel something. Good or bad. You'll love it or hate it. You know what I mean? You know?
Yeah.
You'll either...
You know, we need things like that in our lives. We need things that...
Polarizing things. That
polarize us a little bit.
We do.
Gives you something to stand by.
We do. Because what else are you going to do? You're going to wake up in the morning, your shoulder's going to hurt. You're just going to go to work.
Yeah, and you'll be like, who turned me over in the middle of the night?
Come on. Who did that?
Dang.
Did Mark Zuckerberg come in here and flip me over in the middle of the night?
He might have.
And then serve me this ad?
I don't know.
You know?
Can it see you? Like, maybe it saw you kind of doing that to your arm and, like...
It has cameras.
Looking at... You know what I mean? Like,
no,
you didn't say anything.
I think it knows how old you are, roughly, and I think it was morning time. And it's like, does your shoulder hurt?
Maybe I've never seen that ad before.
Maybe it sensed that you were awake, and it was like, why is this person awake in the middle of the night? And I think I know why. And it served you that
ad. I mean, sure, if I was wearing my watch, it would definitely know. I wasn't wearing my watch when I slept. But, yeah, maybe it's right there next to my bed. It looks at me.
Yeah.
You know?
Could be
thirsty. Oh, I mean, you know, you want to, you know, you do a little digging, you find out any camera you got in your house, someone could be watching you. You know, and all these devices are perpetually listening,
right.
You know?
Yeah.
For sure.
You know, I go, hey, Alexa, hey, Siri, right? It's like stuff maybe just came on wherever you are.
Interesting.
You know what I mean? Hey, Siri.
I tried to hey Tesla when I got in.
Look,
it didn't
my
do
phone
anything.
Just did it over here.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And that happens. And,
have you ever been on the phone, like talking to someone with the phone on your ear, and then you say something that triggers it, but it's you didn't actually mean it, and then in your ear she's like, "I'm sorry, what did you say?"
Yeah.
And it's like deafeningly loud.
You're still on the phone call?
Yeah.
Do you know what I want?
I hate that.
You know what I want them to do with Siri and AI? I need Siri to know that, yes, I want you to read the text to me when someone texts me. But if someone texts me an Instagram reel, I don't need you to read the entire description of the Instagram reel with hashtags.
Right.
I don't need that, yeah. Siri. You can tell
That's
me.
That's so true.
You have to be able to know
oh my gosh.
That you're reading me not a message,
right.
But in fact something shared from an application that has a description that was not meant for me as a message.
Right.
But you know what it did do super smart the other day?
What?
I don't know if you ever had this happen. I had Siri in my ear and I was texting with three people. And if you haven't had this happen, you might not know that this even is an option.
You were texting, hold on. You were texting three different
there's
people.
There's three people in a group message.
Individually or?
No, in a group message, there's three of us.
Okay.
So two other persons. And a person sent a text and it said, Joe sent a text that said, blah, 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 blah. Joe immediately texted just me. And then Siri said, Joe sent a message that said, blah, 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 blah. Joe sent a message privately to you. Joe sent a message privately that said, blah, 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 blah. Meaning it identified that I'm in a group of persons.
Right.
Someone spoke and I'm reading you the text, but I don't identify the group of persons. But I should let you know that Joe just said something not in that group immediately to you, knowing that it's probably something a little more. You should know that he just sent it to you, not in that big group.
Before you respond.
So that you don't panic thinking Joe might have just said something he's not supposed to say out loud to other people, right? Or just so it identified that person chose to communicate with me away from the group. And it told me in my ear, and I went, And I looked at my phone and I went, he did say it privately to me. Like,
I like that.
I like that too. That's smart. Really good AI.
I've also noticed Siri is describing pictures now, like in what she says. So like my wife sent me it was a picture that she took of our son, like holding up a thing he drew.
No.
And it said, Shelly sent you one image of a boy holding a paper.
No.
Stop.
I swear.
Stop.
I swear.
What?
And I was like, what? And I went to go look at it and it was my son holding something he drew.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah. It wasn't just Shelly sent an image. It described what
but
was
it knows
the
who
image.
That is. Cause in your iPhotos, yeah. I bet you anything, his name's already on
it. It didn't say his name. It just said, an image.
No,
of
No. But it knows who maybe it is already. Yeah. It's just not trying to scare.
I've heard it a couple times before, but since then I've also gotten, John sent you one image. So I don't know how it always knows to say, John sent you an image with a dog in it, whatever. But like that shocked me. I was just driving. I was like, what in the world? So it's getting
That's
more accurate.
Awesome.
Yeah.
It is kind of awesome, but I don't know if I like that.
Right.
Well, they have a bunch of that stuff on device now,
Yeah.
So it's not shocking.
No, it's not shocking.
More tech, though. It's kind of impressive.
So much tech.
So much tech.
The tech that's in these phones, you guys, is outrageous.
Mm. And that wasn't an Indian writing that. That was a real AI.
Oh, yeah. Mm. The Amazon thing.
I'm referencing that. I'll just tell you so that people don't think I'm making fun of you. Amazon just came out and admitted that their store, where you could just kind of log in, you just like walk in and say, I'm here now with your account. Your Prime account, you could go into these stores. They had some in Seattle. I don't know where else they had some. And you could just grab whatever you wanted, and then you could just walk out, and it would charge your Amazon account. And, there was a lot of talk of, how did they do this? How do they do this? And it was like, there's cameras. And there were cameras. There were cameras all around. But what they just admitted is that it wasn't really AI. They hired 1,000 people in India to, when you came in, you scanned your thing. So they knew your identity, mm-hmm. and they basically followed you on the cameras, looking at what you were buying, and they had the cameras positioned where they could see what you were grabbing so that they could basically enter a total, and boom, they were custom filling your cart, and then you walked out the door, which is obviously not a scalable solution. Amazon had to know that, but they probably were realizing.
Yeah, but that's way faster than training AI to do it.
Yeah. And now
and more
that,
reliable.
And now that it's probably caught up, though. They just knew this is how the store experience.
How many of
would
those
go.
Stores are there though?
There were only a few. Yeah. It was like a.
It's like
a test.
It was like a test.
Yeah,
thing.
They didn't make it into Whole Foods. Doesn't do that. And
right.
Bought, yeah. So
like the airport ones where you're like, you basically walk in, shop, and walk out. There's nobody there. There was one at B&A for a while.
Yeah, saw one. I don't know if it was at B&A, but it was somewhere where you put all the stuff on a zone, and mm-hmm. there was a camera down, a camera on the side, and it recognized everything. That I believe cameras were doing that, because Google has had that on all the Google phones forever now.
Gotcha.
Where you can take a picture of something and then search it. Take a picture of a Telecaster, and it's like searching Fender Telecaster.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah, or just reverse image
so
search.
Funny.
I mean, they've had that for forever.
That's really right. funny. That
it was
did.
Just I. It wasn't AI.
Yeah, it was just I.
It was human I.
It was just regular
just
old.
Just those people.
It was just OI, organic.
Organic.
Yeah, yeah.
Regular old.
They were born.
Organic intelligence. I saw someone recently ask on a thing. They were like, there's a new sushi place that opened up here. In Franklin. Did you see in North McEwen, north side there?
Oh, yeah.
There's like, I don't know what it's called, but it was, it's kind of a posh place. Mm-hmm. And I saw someone write, do they have organic fish? They said, do they have organic fish? I was, it's been disappointing that that only health sushi in Franklin has organic fish, like in the area. And I look at that term organic fish, and I was like, that has to be not a real thing. Or what's an organic fish? The fish is organic. It is a carbon-based life form.
Right.
Like, that is literally what organic means.
Mm-hmm.
So
did you find out what they meant by it?
Yeah. There's a term that you're only that some bureaucrat you have to follow these certain guidelines to be able to say organic fish, or else your fish are not organic. Basically, what it means is your fish have to there's a couple rules, but it basically comes down to you have to feed your fish only organic stuff during its life, and then there has to be some frequency with which the waste is cleaned out of the tank.
Right.
And so some conditions that fish are grown on fish farms would not categorize, would not classify as organic. I would just say it's always organic. It is literally organic.
You were saying that term already means something.
Yeah. Yes, that's right. They're changing right. what it means.
Right.
And I get how we got here. I get that we say organic vegetables. What we're asking is, did anyone put anything on this product that I can't see that's inorganic?
Right.
That's so organic. Yeah. Organic.
The whole apples. Food is organic. Yeah.
Yes. Right. Like this is. Maybe we should have said just organic.
Right.
You know. Meaning I didn't add anything that wasn't organic because yes. that's really what they're right. trying to identify. We didn't right. put anything on here.
Yeah.
This is an organic fruit. We haven't used yeah. chemicals, sprayed it.
So that's what that person
it.
Wanted to know about the restaurant.
Yeah, but yeah. it's a little different with the fish because no one is really, I don't think anyone's spraying the fish afterwards.
Like, stuff. For instance, if I say, oh, is the beef farm, is it farm-raised beef?
Yes.
Right?
Or grass-fed or whatever
grass-fed
it is.
Beef. Yeah. I don't say organic beef.
No. No,
I sound like an idiot
that.
When I say
yeah.
it like that.
Was the
say,
grass it, organic that you
yeah.
fed to the
is
organic
it grass
beef?
Grass fed? Is it grass finished? You right. can say, I think beef and the same thing can be certified organic, but.
So dumb.
I just, I, yeah, wow. it's very.
The only thing much. I can think of is that a group of people getting paid full time salaries sat in a room and discussed all of this. And then. Legislated it.
Yeah.
And then here we are.
No, like, you're right.
And now here like, we are going, are the fish organic? I don't know if you're that worried, cook it.
Right.
You know? It's just, yeah.
Stop eating that. Sushi. Yeah. Or stop eating profit.
Yeah, I mean, also, there's not an ocean for hundreds of miles in any direction.
No, we're a landlocked
so,
state yeah. over here in Tennessee.
We got
so
some other
not...
concerns about the fish. So,
yeah.
Like
yeah.
maybe. Yeah. You know,
have
get
some
cooked,
shrimp,
have
some crawfish.
Have some cooked.
I don't
stuff.
Think that salmon came out of the Gulf. So no. it's a ways. It's a wow. ways to the ocean. Sorry, man. Are they flying that in every day?
They must be.
They must be. You can get shrimp, though, here that was caught like this morning. And I think they fly it or they drive it. Or you can get stuff that's less than 24 hours old.
Yeah.
Because there's a bunch of restaurants that'll say, like, right off the boat, right to us. And if you right. think about that, it's like, all right. This could have been caught 10, 12 hours ago.
Yeah. I mean, look, even in California, they're importing some fish.
Sure.
Right?
Yeah.
Like, I remember going to a sushi place, and he's like, oh, we have Spanish mackerel from Japan.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And
it's right. like...
Same issue.
Yeah. It's like, yeah. Japan's a long way, even from California.
Yeah. Every right. time I'm paying for that Wagyu, it's...
Yeah.
It's come from a long way.
Exactly.
Unless it's the American Wagyu.
Yeah. But...
Yeah.
So, you know, it exists everywhere, but man, I don't know. That's really funny. Organic
fish. Is that guitar organic? Is that organic wood?
What was added to it?
Is that varnish organic?
Is nitrocellulose
yeah, is
organic?
That...
Oh, gosh.
For sure not.
I better make sure we recycle these
everything,
guitars.
The whole time you were saying all of that, I was thinking, so there's a YouTube channel.
Yeah.
Called Nile Red.
Yeah.
If you haven't watched it, this guy, he's a chemist.
Is his name Nile Red or is
that's
this like
the
a biblical
name of the
reference?
Channel. No, it's the name of the channel.
Got it.
He has like Nile Blue, Nile Red. He has a bunch
okay,
of channels.
Okay, okay, okay.
But he's a chemist.
Yes.
And he makes the wildest things. So like he mm-hmm. made grape soda out of rubber gloves
yes.
one time.
Yeah. Out of rubber gloves.
Rubber gloves. Plastic gloves, and then he made grape soda out of them. And he like literally shows you the chemistry of like, okay, now I'm doing this and now to do this. And it's like took days and days or whatever. And so the whole time you were thinking or the whole time you were saying all of that, I just was thinking like everything's chemicals, you know?
Right. That's like, a whole nother thing. Yeah. Yeah.
It's all just chemicals. Yeah. Your body either knows what to do with it or it doesn't.
Like well, that fish yeah. was made, not born.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like it's like, they
yeah.
fish.
And you get into that when it's like, you know, this releases toxins.
Yeah.
What the hell is that? What do you mean it releases toxins? What a toxin? What toxins?
I know.
You know, toxins.
Yeah. You like know? Alcohol is a toxin.
Mm-hmm. It's all toxins.
Just releases them, though.
Just releases them.
Like
what through your sweat.
Like, I don't understand though. Were they already in there and it just released?
Well, they were trapped.
Need to be
released. They were captive.
They were trapped.
They're released.
They need to be released.
Right.
Dude, listen, it's the same thing though you hear where it's like, you know, you don't want to eat greasy food because, or you don't want to give your teenager greasy food because they'll break out. Mm-hmm. Right. And then but if you actually like think about that claim for a second, it's like, don't eat greasy food so that your face isn't as greasy. Let's like pause and think just for a moment about the path that all food takes as it goes into your body. Is anything staying? Maybe don't take the pizza and rub it on your face, but nothing you're taking in stays in its form. And then somehow your body's like, throw that grease that we just got on its face. There's right. no like, it's not being like read. It's not.
There's no path. There's yeah. no direct path from your stomach yeah. to your face.
No, there's like a dispatcher in there. That's just like grease goes there. This goes here. You know, you even I mean, it's not like you eat. I mean, because it's like this, it's like you eat protein. And what does your body do with protein? Like the first thing you think of, like it's how you build muscle.
Right.
You know, it doesn't stay in that form to build your muscle. It doesn't like take, it's not like a piece of steak you ate.
Turns into your muscle. Right.
I mean, it does, but it becomes like an acid first.
Yeah. It like breaks it down.
It's like a liquid
yeah.
thing. And then you actually build it back up.
I just watched a 1-hour and 20-minute video this morning mm-hmm. about these three scientists who are basically talking about how evolution couldn't have happened really even by Darwin's own like there's like a bunch of stuff that they're talking about
right like,
when Darwin wrote The Evolution of Species, their microscopes they had back then were like, he's like, they said that it looked like goo, like a cell looked like jelly.
Yeah.
Basically. Mm-hmm. Well, now we know that there's like an incredibly complex set of
like structure,
mechanical
cell, yeah.
machines that live in your cells that yeah. like do all of this work. And they're yeah. all made from proteins. Yeah. So that's what these things, that's why you need protein, is because inside the cell of your body, inside every right, cell of your right. body are machines that yeah. are made out of these proteins.
Yeah.
And they break down and they have to reproduce and all yeah. of these things. So you need more to make more.
Right.
So yeah, it's not like the right. muscle tissue from the cow
yeah.
gets converted straight yeah. into muscle.
And the outside of the cell is made of cholesterol. Don't have that though. Don't eat that. Fat free. Here, eat this bread instead. Okay.
We've lost everyone at this point.
Everyone's gone. Everyone's gone. Well, you just went to anti-Darwin, but then earlier we were pro-thick pick, so that crossover doesn't work.
Interesting.
I didn't say I was anti-Darwin.
Do you know what the...
I didn't say I wasn't, but I didn't say I was.
Do you know what the James Webb telescope did just discover? This is the strongest evidence of why the Big Bang Theory is like not a good theory, actually. Hmm. And this wasn't known until... just this James Webb discovery. So if you, and people can look this up, the theory has always been that space is expanding, but we've assumed that it expands at a constant rate. And mm-hmm. the reason we would assume that is we've seen this expanding. We haven't seen measurements that show it's not expanding at a different rate. Mm-hmm. You know, that there's a rate in which space is expanding. Mm-hmm. And that makes sense. And we go, yeah, then this, and our theory of this big bang origin, you know, or what I'll call single point origin,
mm-hmm.
right, in space,
yeah.
that there is a point at which something happens that
right.
starts.
Because the theory goes, if it's all expanding, if you
there must have
flip
been a single
time
point
in reverse,
origin,
it's all yeah. contracting.
Yes, a right. single point origin. And so, but what the James Webb telescope, which is much higher fidelity than the Hubble telescope, is that it's looking around and it uses the color of the light that it gets back to tell mm-hmm. if objects are moving closer or further away or whatever. And what they can measure is that certain parts of the universe are expanding more rapidly than others.
Hmm.
And this is perplexing, like very perplexing.
Yeah.
So like we know that space is expanding. Not just things are moving away from each other, but the space in between things is getting larger. Mm-hmm. So the nothing in between the something, the matter, mm-hmm. is getting bigger. So things are moving away from each other. But at some spots, they're moving, that space is growing at a faster rate, which, you know, what causes that? What would cause that? So it really brings doubt to the theory that space is still expanding from the force of a singular event in a particular, I hate to say for this, for in a one space, in one spot.
Right.
You know, but whatever the force that expands space is apparently
not equally distributed.
Not equally distributed. Right. Which would cast some doubt that it's energy happening from
originates from a singular from point. Yeah.
So I don't know what that proves. Nothing really, other than we often take a guess, get some things wrong, and then don't really have a better guess.
There you go.
You know,
you got to look further.
I got a better guess.
Dark matter.
I was going to say Jesus, John, but you
no dark you matter. Do your own. I think it's dark matter.
Okay. Suze is visibly bored. I'll let you guess the time it's been now.
I was like, try to pay attention to what he's saying. Try to care. And then it's like, it went away.
It went away.
You'll be pleased to know I tried.
What would you guess we're at now, Suze?
Hour 36.
Interesting.
I was going to say like hour 10, hour 15.
Wow. So my prediction was correct just later on. Suze is higher than the actual time and John's time. We're at an hour 28 by my watch, a little less because we've probably edited out all the offensive content.
Wait, I think I was 8 minutes off on both of them or 9 minutes off.
Interesting.
Suze
is in the part of space that expands faster.
Edited out all the offensive. We made it to episode 29. And then we had to start cutting stuff out.
Suze has already just started playing guitar. over the...
It says
he's
guitar
like, this
friends.
Is guitar friends.
It says it right behind you.
Suze, will that chord reach you? Do you want to play us out?
He doesn't want to.
He doesn't want to play us out?
I'll play us out.
You do it. That thing sounds cool.
All right, let me join you.